Our first item is to welcome to the Health, Social Care and Sport Committee. Our first item is to decide whether to take items 3, 4, 5 and 6 in private. Are members agreed?
Agreed.
Second item today is an evidence session with the Scottish Government on the Transvaginal Mesh Removal Cost Reimbursement Scotland Bill. And we have our officials from the bill team who are participating remotely. They are Greg Chalmers, the head of Chief Medical Officer's Policy Division. Sorry, I'm just hearing some feedback. I'm not quite sure why. Apologies, everyone, that's better. David Bishop, the Mesh Team Leader. Terry O'Kelly, the Senior Medical Advisor. Ilsa Garland, solicitor, and Kate Walker, solicitor from Scottish Government. And I would invite members to ask questions just by, I've got a note of the kind of questions that you want to ask, but I'm going to ask the bill team initially some questions about the specialist mesh removal services. I would like to get an idea of just where we are with that at the moment. Well, we've obviously reached out to mesh survivors around this, and that's a question certainly that they have around the mesh removal services as they stand. So I'm not quite sure who I would go to. Would it be Mr. Chalmers?
Good morning, Convener. Perhaps on that question, I might defer to my medical advisor, Terry O'Kelly. I know he's been closely involved in the service.
Thank you.
Morning, Convener and rest of the committee. Welcome from a very rainy Aberdeen. The specialist mesh service in Scotland was established following work undertaken by a short life working group consisting of accountable officers and representative parties. This is funded for the first 3 years by additional money from the Scottish Government. The centre is housed within NHS Greater Glasgow and Clyde and has been operational now for over a year. You will appreciate that the work of the unit has been inhibited to an extent by the COVID pandemic, but considerable progress has been made. I think not only in establishing a fully functioning multidisciplinary team with recruitment of new clinicians, and those are both medical and non-medical clinicians, and we are now able to offer, I think, a truly holistic service for women with mesh-related complications. At the moment, the work is ongoing. We have a service review next month, and we're looking for updates on patient experience and early outcomes. That's going to be important. There is a service level agreement in place, which we've had a lot of input into. And I think that across the United Kingdom, where other centres are being established, both in England, designated centre in Wales, sorry, in Northern Ireland, and centres being established in Wales, Scottish Centre is seen as leading. Leading because of the clinical expertise that is on offer, and it's leading because of public and patient engagement. And we're very grateful, not only for colleagues in Glasgow, but also working with the Scottish Health and Social Care Alliance, who are taking that forward. We appreciate that, and I think everyone does, the sensitivities involved in this care, that the women who have suffered need to have confidence re-established, and we're working towards that. And we're working towards that not only through providing good experience, good outcomes, and that's what we're looking for, but also ensuring that the skills of our surgeon are credentialed, and that's is a process that's being established through the Royal College of Obstetricians, Royal College of Surgeons, and the General Medical Council. And we have been very actively engaged in that, promoting that and ensuring that moves forward as quickly as possible. And finally, I think one of the issues that was a major problem previously was information, shared decision making, and with the background of realistic medicine, we are and have been intimately involved in developing the new guidance, GMC guidance on consent, and also engaging with services across United Kingdom to make sure we've got information, we've got patient decision aids, and that those are seen to be and are acceptable for patients going forward. Thank you.
Over the years since the Mesh Survivors Group have been petitioning, there'll be a lot of testimony as to what happened to them and where that trust dissolved in the people who had been removing the mesh. Can I ask how that has informed how these services are going forward? You're talking about the clinicians involved and the surgeons involved and the work that you're doing and the expertise that you have. What learning has come from the mistakes of the past or the practices of the past that has led to the point that we are with this bill?
Well, I think we've drawn on the experiences of patients very much, and that is not only has it been used to craft and mould the service, but will continue to do so going forward. So we heard the voices in Scotland of the women, and I think one has to accept that and recognise that the bravery of the women to come forward, to keep pressing their points, often when their views and their pleas for help weren't listened to. And I think that there was that perception, and I think just given the numbers of patients that were involved, there must have been a lot of reality in that. And that was borne out not only here in Scotland, but also by Baroness Cumberledge and the experience of her committee in Westminster Parliament. So we have heard those voices. We recognise that there are lessons to be learned. And I think if we look across at the policy areas that are being developed with regard to mesh, then I think those lessons have been learned, and what learning there is being applied.
Thank you. Could I bring in Emma Harper? Emma.
Thanks, Convener. Good morning to everybody. I'm interested in issues around total mesh removal versus partial, but also some of the procedures are quite complicated, and then there might be subsequent surgeries that would be required. So does the bill cover additional, like, wider requirements for women that need, I suppose, concomitant surgeries?
Convener, perhaps I might start. Greg Chalmers here. Perhaps I might start on the bill, and then I'll defer to Terry in terms of the kind of clinical aspects of your question there. So in relation to the point about whether the bill provides for reimbursement where there's been more than one surgery, then yes, it does. Up at that point in the explanatory notes, because we're aware that, as the member has said, the successful surgery can require more than one surgery. Yes, I think we cover that in paragraph 10 of the explanatory notes. Forgive me, Terry. You might want to comment on the kind of surgical aspect of that.
Well, I think for some women, the issues that are related to mesh and complications and care going forward are very complex. I think these are, and I'm speaking to you as a clinical surgeon here in Aberdeen, Scotland. These are not really the domain of private practice and private hospitals. These These are the domain of major NHS centres with all the infrastructure and services that can be offered for women. And that was the point that we raised through the Accountable Officers Short Life Working Group, and was echoed by Baroness Cumberledge. Care for women is dependent on a multidisciplinary team, and we have to be able to offer them holistic care. Now, I think the bill really covers the primary assessment and removal of mesh. It may be that women will come forward having had further care following that, but I think that the principal aim is to of the bill is to reimburse women who have had mesh removed. That act rather than ongoing management. And with the referral possibilities for care out with the NHS that are being established, again, that will predominantly involve the physical removal of the mesh rather than any reconstructive or additional procedures or clinical interventions that are required, such as chronic pain management or psychosexual counselling, etc. These are, as I say, the domains of the multidisciplinary team, and I think they are the domain of major NHS centres.
Elsa Garland wants to come in before I go back to Emma Harper. Elsa.
I just wondered if I could just add to what Greg and Terry have said, just to clarify that the bill gives power to ministers to make a scheme, and it's, as is set out in the bill itself, the cost of being reimbursed will include the cost of the removal surgery itself, but we do have ministers will have power to cover other costs, which could include if there was more than one, for example, more than one surgery needed to remove mesh. So we've got quite a broad power within the bill to have these things in the scheme, and that those are things that can be considered as the scheme is drafted. Thank you.
Thanks for that. Just we heard earlier about a person who needed additional time because of a pre-existing condition that needed to be managed with really constrained thrombolysing therapy. So if somebody required additional time because of additional, health conditions, would that be included as well?
Come back to Elsa Garland.
Thank you, convener. Again, this is something that we can consider in the scheme. In the scheme itself, as you know, to what other costs could be included in addition to the mesh, the main mesh removal surgery. I don't know if the kind of the additional time is perhaps a longer period of time in accommodation while treatment's being carried out. But you know, these are things that could be considered as we look at the kind of the shape of the scheme itself.
We've heard from many women, and they have all said that there should be a degree of flexibility, because every single person's case, when they have gone for this surgery, whether it's been in Bristol or in the States, they've been different. There've been different circumstances. There's been different, as Emma has mentioned, they've maybe had different health complications, and they want to see that recognised and flexibility, like, you know, if you don't fit into a particular box but you still have incurred a lot of cost, that there is that flexibility. Do you believe the bill as it stands allows for that?
If I may, convener, yes, I think certainly the bill does allow for that flexibility in setting up the scheme. I don't know whether there's possibly been a slight misunderstanding in terms of the costs that were set out in the financial memorandum, which were sort of estimated costs that were used to estimate the costs overall of the bill. I don't think the intention is that there would be a specific cap for things like the mesh removal surgery, that would be covered in full, and then we would look maybe to more to set out what would be considered reasonable in terms of accommodation and travel costs, etc. But certainly there is that degree of flexibility in the bill. So it's not that, for example, the 20,000 estimate for surgery was just really in order to get an idea of what the total cost of the bill would be, rather than saying that the scheme might say, well, we're only going to cover up to that 20,000 limit.
Okay, and we might dig into that later. Some members have some questions on the financial memorandum in particular, so that's good to have that to dig into later. Can I bring in Evelyn Tweed?
Thank you, Convener. I very much welcome Terry O'Kelly's comment on us moving towards a holistic approach. How will you assess success here of the specialist service, and how will patients' reported outcomes be collected and reported?
We'll come to Terry O'Kelly.
Yeah, I think patients, when it comes to holistic care, we can look at how patients are managed through a process of management in an episode, let's say hospital admission or some other practice of care, and you could measure that, set up a pathway, and then measure against it. And that would be reasonable for things like, you know, pain management, and you know, I'm sure that could be done. And similarly with you know, psychological inputs, etc. But I think when it comes down to it, it is with regards to it would be patient experience. When patients engage with the centre, what were their expectations at the start? How were those expectations addressed, and what was their final opinion? And I think that's really important. We should be able to measure that relatively early. With regard to outcomes, again, there are early outcomes, but going forward for the patient, and those could be patient orientated, but there will be later outcomes. What is the, you know, the legacy of the care going forward? And that is being looked at and addressed across the United Kingdom by an oversight group, setting up a database which will morph into a registry over time. And that's being led by NHS Digital. We're engaged with that, got pilots running here in Scotland. The PROM is an issue. There are some established PROMs which are validated. The MESH survivors, not unsurprisingly, would like one bespoke for MESH and MESH complications. But one of the difficulties is that these PROMs take some time to establish. They take a longer time to validate. And I think it is important that as we go forward, we have an eye on that, something that might be bespoke, but also try to apply something which is present and exists at the moment, so that we can get an early handle on patient-reported outcomes to know and be sure that what we're doing is correct and is addressing what women, not only what they want, but also what they need. Pretty vital.
Okay. Sue Webber?
Yes, thank you. And I suppose my question goes to Terry as well, so thank you for that. We've heard a lot from some of the witnesses this morning about the challenges they've had with the logistics in managing that private sector experience, whether it be in the US or in England. So I'm just, but also the challenges they have with gaining that trust with the NHS service. And obviously an NHS-based service will be much better at managing the anticipated and the unplanned outcomes of the complex surgery. So what are we doing to sort of reassure and sort of benchmark that we are going to have some of the best mesh removal specialist services in Scotland again?
So I think, Sue, this is something that is very much in the forefront of my mind and actions. We want to change the narrative, but to do that, we can't just say to women and mesh survivors, we've got a great service, etc. What we actually have to do is demonstrate through evidence that we have a centre which is as good as any in the world, and we hope is world leading. And to do that, I think we need credentialing, and that we need that as soon as possible. We need the skills of our surgeons to be accredited. And we need evidence, hard, really robust evidence of excellent patient outcomes, patient experience, and also outcomes. Now, at the start of this centre, those experiences I think we can look at very early. The outcomes are going to be based on initial measures rather than the long-term legacy. But it is through providing women with hard evidence that we're going to be able to change the narrative and lead them to want to use our centres in Scotland. One appreciates, absolutely appreciates, the lack of trust and the issues with confidence. And what we have to do with the service here in Scotland and across the United Kingdom is to do our best to restore that. But it's not something that's within my gift. What we have to do is provide the information, and it will be for women to judge and to value the experiences of their peers who have gone through that service. But the initial measurements experience are extremely encouraging. And I would encourage women to, going forward, to look at those, to speak to our clinical teams and to open their eyes to what's available here in Scotland before they decide to go anywhere else.
Yes. Thank you. I suppose on that, Terry, you spoke in one of your earlier statements that you had some new staff coming on board. So where are we recruiting the staff from? What areas of expertise that we have that weren't in the team perhaps before in terms of that multidisciplinary element?
So I think there are some surgeons who were here in Scotland and work in Glasgow, but they've been augmented by colleagues from the rest of the United Kingdom. So we are now up to complement with removal surgeons. So if a woman chose not to have clinical contact with one of the surgeons who perhaps has been responsible for care in the past, then she could state that and elect to have her be managed by another colleague. With regard to the others, we have pain management, nurse specialists, and I think those are really important additions to this clinical team.
Thank you. Gillian Mackay.
So I'm really interested in how we can support these women's mental health in particular, and whether any consideration within the bill was given to reimbursing maybe private medical costs. A lot of what we heard from MESH survivors earlier this morning was that some have lost confidence in the centre in Glasgow itself, and some will probably have lost confidence in the Scottish NHS as a whole and may want to be seen privately for what has been a traumatising event for many of them. So I just want to see if there's been consideration given to paying for or reimbursing, for example, private counselling and other things that may be outside just the MESH removal itself, but may actually help these women recover.
Yeah, convener, perhaps I might start on that, and then other colleagues might want to contribute. The bill at the moment in section one of the scheme that Ilse refers to is concerned in the first place with MESH removal surgery. That'll be clear to the committee members. We do have, as Ilse has already said, a scope to refer to other costs specified, to refer to other costs in the scheme. At the moment, our intention would be that the main focus is on the surgery and on necessary preparatory steps towards the surgery and the accommodation and arrangements around the surgery. And I suppose the reason for that focus it comes back to the kind of the primary intention behind the bill, which is that the government has decided, as members know, to commence arrangements to procure surgery in the independent sector, and the purpose of the bill is to reimburse people who entered into private costs, essentially not knowing and having no reason to know that the government was about to do that. And so that is the primary focus of the bill, and that's the reasoning around it. I suppose, acknowledging what the member has asked, it is of course the case that services of the type that she's referred to in terms of mental health support and other important matters have and will have been and will continue to be available as normal through the NHS, whereas of course in the past the mesh removal surgery it wasn't available through the independent sector. So I think we highlight that there is scope for matters connected to the surgery to be included in the scheme, but the general it's not the intention of the government that the whole scope of a person's health needs might be covered by the scheme, even though there will be things connected to the surgery that are. Hope that's helpful.
Any more questions? Can I ask what's proposed in terms of the options and making it clear to women that present what the options might be, because obviously the bill allows for patient choice, that they can opt to have their surgery in Scotland or other parts of the UK, or they could opt to have it privately. How is that going to be made clear to women what the options are, and how much is it going to be patient-centred and their choices respected? I'd really like to hear how that is going to be communicated. Not also just to the patient, but also to their GPs, because one of the things that we have heard from women is maybe sometimes a lack of understanding about mesh and the complications of mesh that at GP level as well. So I wonder if you can cover that.
Surely, happy to do that. And I think your question, convener, usefully highlights what is covered in the bill and what isn't. So the bill is focused on surgery that has taken place in the past, things that have happened, and so it is only about that reimbursement of monies already spent. The bill doesn't cover what you've described there correctly as the range of service and surgery options now available to patients in the future. As Terry has already explained, one of the primary parts of those options is the mesh removal centre in Glasgow. There's also now the option developing of surgery in NHS England and potentially other parts of the UK, and then the work underway now arrangements for the independent sector. So those three options in the present, they are separate from the bill. Obviously these issues of course are connected, but the bill is very much focused on the past to make sure that people
The reason we're asking is because we do also want to know about the specialist mesh services, so that's why we're asking quite a few questions around that as well as the reimbursement. So just to be clear.
No, completely understood, convener, and that's I think a convenient moment for me to ask Terry maybe to talk about the sorts of conversations that you're asking about that will inform which choice people go for.
Thank you. I think we have to be clear that the needs for a number of patients is complex, and it would be foolish, I think, to divorce a surgical procedure from a pathway of care which must involve services near to home, as well as those perhaps which are further away. It is important that patients with problems are seen by their local clinical teams, and I accept there may be potential issues around that, but that is really important, because it is that local team which will pick up the problems if they occur, which are urgent or occur as an emergency. In discussion with colleagues in the local teams, and we've been working with the boards throughout, there will be onward referral to the specialist mesh centre in Glasgow, and it's reasonable that patients are assessed here in Scotland. There will then be a conversation with the patient about what they want. And I think that, I speak to you as a clinician who has been involved in similar issues with managing complex problems with inflammatory bowel disease, patients wanting to do go to various places. But there has to be a discussion about what is in their best interest, and making sure that going forward, that by acting in a certain way, that care isn't prejudiced. And I think we've been clear that the management of any patient must be linked to a competent multidisciplinary team for appropriate discussions, and that we are a primary aim is to encourage patients and show patients the best care they're going to get is in Scotland. If, however, that does not prove, we are unable to reconcile issues to allow care to go forward in Scotland, what we will then advise is that referral to a mesh centre in NHS England, Northern Ireland or Wales would be appropriate. And you know, that can be discussed and a decision made about that. If, however, and all those centres in England will provide similar services to the centre in Scotland, again linked to credentialing, measurement of experience and outcomes to benchmark the outcome of pathway of care, the process of care will also be benchmarked and categorised and identified. If after all that, a woman feels that she just can't undergo surgery within our NHS, and I think that is a tragedy, but it is, we recognise the reality, then there will be the possibility for surgery either, at the moment the discussions are ongoing, possibility of surgery out with the NHS in two places, one potentially here in United Kingdom and one in America. But that care must be tied into a competent multidisciplinary team. So it cannot be that the women embark on management, which is not overseen by the multidisciplinary team. We recognise that it's really important. Baroness Cumberledge did, and the clinical teams do, and I'm sure the women do as well. It's important to ensure that any intervention is part of a pathway of care and doesn't prejudice what might be necessary or what is present going forward.
Can I just ask one other question on this before we move on to talking about the bill to Mr. O'Kelly? If a woman who's had a mesh inserted into her that she's had problems with and it's been removed by a surgeon, if they have a nervousness about that surgeon who put the mesh into their bodies also being the surgeon who might remove it, is that taken into account and respected?
Yes, as I said, locally, it depends where the woman had their surgery, but in Scotland, if they engage with our mesh removal service, then yes, there are clinicians there who were there previously, but we have recruited new surgeons. These are well-trained, well-supported, and will be credentialed. And a woman absolutely has the right to elect to have care undertaken by that individual.
Thank you. Can I bring in Stephanie Callaghan?
Thank you, Convener, and thanks for being here today. We heard some talk earlier about the importance of trust and mentioning that there's now a full complement of staff and the required expertise at the specialist centres. And we heard from women today, some who'd already been treated by Dr. Veronicus, that NHS imaging often can't see mesh as it's placed behind the bone. And also about Dr. Veronicus designing and developing new specialist surgical tools. And what I'm wondering is, have our specialist centres considered these issues and these developments? Have there been lessons learned and incorporated into the processes? And ask this because, you know, I think this would be a real step in the right direction to re-establishing that trust. Thanks.
Mr. Kelly?
Do you want me to take that?
Yes.
Yes, I think clearly Dr. Veronicus, I've been involved with MESH since 2014, and Dr. Veronicus has been an important figure in development of surgery. And he has, there's no doubt about it, gained the trust of women, not only here in not in America, here in the United Kingdom, but elsewhere across the world. His techniques, I don't think, are unique. And it is inevitable that surgeons they do develop abilities to undertake procedures. The evidence that we have, published evidence, is that the process and outcome of care offered by Dr. Veronicus and surgeons elsewhere is no different for those who have expressed specialisation in this type of surgery, and that would include our surgeons in Scotland. Dr. Veronicus is a high volume surgeon. I think he's technically, I'm sure, very competent. And what we need to make sure is that the care, surgical care that we offer, is at least as good as him, if not better, but supported by all the other services that women need. And I think what we also need to be is we need to offer a service which is responsive to women's wants and needs, and can demonstrate that those responses have taken place. And certainly the initial experience with this new service in Glasgow is that they are actually listening to what women are saying and responding. And, you know, I think that's tremendous. And responding not only in words, but actually in actions. But it is an iterative process. And, you know, as something changes, which was important, has improved, something else comes along. So, you know, this is an evolving service. And I think we would like to see it being an exemplar for how services are developed across Scotland, not only for women's medicine and surgery, but for other specialties as well. It is, after all, the people's service.
Thank you. We're now going to move on to talking about the reimbursement scheme and questions from David Torrens.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, everyone. How long will the scheme last, and will there be any time limits on reimbursement? And if there is a time scale, how is that going to be decided?
Thank you, Mr. Torrens. I might start, and I might ask David Bishop to contribute as well here. Our present intention goes without saying, of course, that all these rough timings that I'm about to mention are dependent on proceedings on the bill, but our present intention is that the scheme will open not very long after royal assent, and that it will be widely publicised to the interested people. It won't surprise the committee. Hopefully the committee will be encouraged to know that we have a hopefully now reasonably well-developed system of consultation with interested people through the Health and Social Care Alliance, who've been very useful in developing policy, but also through National Services Scotland, which, as the committee will probably know too, has been leading on the implementation of the present MESH fund, which has been in operation for a little while now. So we would expect the scheme to offer open only a few months after royal assent, and then be available for a period. We would expect there to be a closing date. We haven't come to a final view on what that a closing, the duration of the scheme being open will be, but it could, for example, be approximately a year. And we would hope that during that time, it would be practicable to bring it to the attention of everybody that's potentially eligible, and to give them a very reasonable period to submit an application. And as is the case now with the Scottish Government Mesh Fund, there will of course be circumstances where an application needs to be added to or explored a little bit, so that the particular circumstances can be confirmed. But we would hope that that will be possible under this arrangement as well. Not least because, as already has been said in the committee, there are a variety of circumstances here. Of course, as reading the, seeing the bill, it provides for a copy of the scheme to be laid before the Parliament after royal assent. That's helpful.
How will reasonable costs by individuals be defined in the bill? And I think I heard earlier there would be no cap on surgery costs, but will there be a cap on daily costs?
Well, I'll start on this, if I may, and then I might bring in my colleague David Bishop, who was to the financial memorandum. I hope reasonableness you will be looking to the evidence of the situation, that the surgery costs, we will be looking to reasonable proof of what those costs were, and that we've got some intelligence around the rough costs of that. In terms of the reasonableness of travel and accommodation, in drawing up the financial memorandum, I suppose what we've tried to do is to look to the reality of somebody planning this travel on their own, through their own budgets, and through what the access that you and I and anyone else would have to travel and accommodation on the internet, and those advised by the centres that they were actually attending. So David, perhaps you might want to say a little bit about the estimates that we came to in the financial memorandum.
Of course, thanks, Greg. Yeah, and I suppose it's important to say, you know, at the outset, they very much are estimates, you know, they were based on the intelligence that we had at the time through the likes of correspondence and all of that. But I mean, what I would say is that in the period since doing that, and drawing up the scheme, which we're obviously still working on at the moment, we've been taking evidence from women who have lived experience of doing this. We've been getting that evidence via the Alliance. So obviously we'll take all of that into account as we draw up the scheme, which as I say we're doing at the moment. And I think as part of that, there was a question in there about sort of capped rates and similar. And I would say what we're doing around all of that is engaging with women at the moment to see really what evidence we think that they think they can practically provide to support their application. So, you know, it may be that they haven't kept evidence for sort of smaller amounts, that kind of thing, whereas they probably do have evidence for the sort of, if you like, big ticket items like the treatment and so on, I suppose. So that's the kind of thing that we're considering around reasonableness and around what sort of caps might be applied and whether caps are appropriate at all or whatever. But I mean, I think it's important to say that it's very much a work in progress at the moment. And we'll continue to engage with women as we continue to draw up the scheme. So yeah.
Thank you for that answer. Many of these women have had to take their husbands, partners or family members with them for support. Will the bill include the reimbursement of their costs?
Yes, they will, Mr. Horns.
Thank you. Sue Webber.
Thank you, Convener. I think from what we heard this morning, the biggest issue appears to be with the women having the money up front to fund this, because this is ultimately a reimbursement bill. And we've also heard that there could be some significant ongoing costs that are unplanned for regarding to the removal of the mesh and the surgery and the complications, in particular, obviously, when they're accessing this through the private sector. So is there something that we can do to really help that? Because this is a really, it's not a very equal service. If there's women out there that can't have the resources to have the money now to pay up front and then claim back, they can't then access what this bill is trying to achieve.
Well, I think maybe what we try and kind of highlight is that, as apologies for repeating myself, but the bill here is concerned about things that have happened in the past, and people spending their own private money and trying to make sure that they are appropriately and reasonably reimbursed for that. In terms of what happens now and in the future, as Terry and others have said, focus is on continuing to improve the specialist centre at Glasgow. And as Terry has always has also said, it's not just about the surgery; it's about the breadth of services of all sorts of different types. And those, of course, will be free through the NHS as normal. And of course, I omitted to say earlier, which I should have mentioned, we still also have the continuing Scottish Government Mesh Fund, which is providing help for people affected by mesh complications. And that fund remains open at present.
Yep, sorry, thank you for clarifying that, Greg. Very helpful. I suppose if these women that have had the surgery then for their mesh removal, but it's not quite gone to what they expect, the outcome, you know, how, when the outcome's not been as successful as they hoped or for, and there's still an awful lot of ongoing issues, how will that be covered or facilitated within this bill?
Well, that's a very fair question, but it's not actually the subject matter of the bill. But I think perhaps I might bring Terry on this, because I think your question is focused on what happens in the present when any surgery happening now isn't quite as successful as patient and surgeon would hope for. Terry, would you like to?
As Greg said, the reimbursement bill is about care that occurred previously. And what we are addressing through our work, through the work NHS and the NHS more broadly, is care for women going forward. And I think if patients have had remedial surgery, which has not achieved their expectations, and further management is required, then this is absolutely the domain of the multidisciplinary team. It is about engagement with patients, understanding what their issues are, what it is that they want, and how that can be achieved. Now, I think in reality, it is unlikely that if surgery is involved in further remedial surgery, that is going to be the domain for out of NHS care. I mean, that's the truth, because I think we're then into pretty complex engagements, which might themselves be associated with risk. Having said that, it may be that there is a bit of a residual mesh, and that might be appropriate for care elsewhere. But again, it would have to be through discussion, centered on what the patient wants, but importantly, I think, taking into account what the true needs are, and trying to align those opinions. And I recognise that may not be what every woman wants to hear, and maybe what the committee doesn't want to hear. But it is the truth. We do have to make sure that in managing patients, that we absolutely take into account what they want, but we have to also align what they want to what is required and what is reasonable.
Just finally, convener, is that okay? A very quick one. So is that, Terry, is that the realistic medicine that you referred to earlier on, I suppose, in the discussion today?
Yes, it is, absolutely. And I think that that is dominating the way that we are going forward in the health service in Scotland. We talk about realistic medicine. It's people sometimes say this is cheap medicine, but it actually is addressing what do people want, and it's seldom that actually clinicians ask that question. It is empowering for patients. It's there are experts involved in all this. There is the clinician who knows about the disease, the processes, treatments, but also it's about the patient. They're the experts about themselves. Sometimes patients' expectations and wants might be unrealistic, but it's trying to find some way that we can help them to give them as much as we possibly can along that wants, but also what they need.
Okay. Evelyn Tweed and I have a couple of questions around the reimbursement and what it might cover and eligibility and proof. One of the things I'm not quite clear on is if a woman had mesh surgery involving mesh in Scotland, but then when she was opting to go whatever that was privately and have the mesh removed, but wasn't resident in Scotland at the time, but maybe even be back in Scotland now, she's not eligible for this reimbursement. Is that correct? If she wasn't resident in Scotland at the time of the mesh removal surgery that she has paid for herself.
If I've understood that question correctly, convener, I'll be careful to check the record that I am understanding correctly. I think that's correct. Section 13B says that the qualifying surgery is surgery in relation to a person who was, at the time the surgery was arranged, ordinarily resident in Scotland. And the surgery that we're talking about here is the removal surgery. That is the thing that that is being reimbursed. I don't know if Ailes, would you like to add to that, if we've understood the convener's question correctly?
The mesh removal surgery, if the person wasn't resident of Scotland at the time they were having that is not included.
To be absolutely precise in answering you, convener, at the time the surgery was arranged. Now, there can, of course, be a gap. There will be a gap, of course, between the surgery being arranged and it happening. But if the person was not ordinarily resident in Scotland at the time the mesh removal surgery was arranged, that is not within the scope of a possible scheme. Ailsa, do you want to clarify anything I've said there? Ailsa?
Sorry, I don't know. Am I unmuted now?
No,
thank you. Just to say that thank you, Greg set that out correctly, that it's the key point is when the surgery was arranged, if the person was ordinarily resident in Scotland at that point, then they would be they're eligible to be reimbursed.
Okay, thank you. And you've covered some of the things. I mean, David mentioned that there might be some smaller expenses that a person maybe had the removal surgery a good few years ago. You know, things like taxis and meals and whatever, they've not kept the receipt. They never thought they were going to be reimbursed for it. There's going to be a flexibility there, I understand, around that. But if somebody has paid for their... The way they've raised money to pay for their surgery has been taking out a loan. Now, that obviously has an additional cost in terms of interest. Is that sort of thing going to be covered by the reimbursement? Oh, you're not unmuted. If I can ask broadcasting to unmute Greg. Carry
right. On. I think that's me now. Yeah, so I'll just repeat what I said there. I think, convener, we want to give that careful consideration in terms of the exact working of the scheme. It's a point that we can undertake to reflect upon from your question. We have, for example, in the explanatory materials, reflected that in some cases it may be that people have received donations through crowdfunding and other things, and that's a relevant thing to take into account. And so clearly, circumstances where people have the overall the financial cost to the person, which will obviously need reasonable documentary evidence to be available. If it's a large amount of money, I think is something that we will be happy to reflect upon in the drawing up of the scheme.
A person has applied for reimbursement and they're not satisfied with the level of money that they have been given as a result of their application. What avenues might be open to them to challenge that?
But that is the potential to cover that in the scheme is addressed in section 2 H of the bill, and it will be the intention that the scheme covers a route of review. And I think, David, you might be able to clarify this. I think there's a route of review at the moment in relation to the Scottish Government, the present Scottish Government Mesh Fund.
There is, yeah, and we're working through the detail of, the reimbursement scheme and, how an appeal process might work. But yes, we are looking at including one in this as well. So yeah, it's something that we're giving consideration to, yeah. Mm-hmm.
Thank you. Evelyn, you had some questions around this.
I've got one question left, convener, because you've asked quite a lot. Could I ask, if a woman comes forward to use the scheme as set out in the bill and she's unhappy with the outcome, how can she get redress? Where would she go to say, I'm not happy about what's been offered, and how could we help with that? Thank you.
Well, I think, as David kind of alluded to before, we do intend that the scheme will cover an explanation of how a review can happen. We will kind of explain this in detail in the scheme. I imagine that in the ordinary course of events, the process of review will be through the body, which in all likelihood will be National Services Scotland. Who have been considering the application, but the scheme will establish a route for somebody to ask for a review or indeed to make a complaint.
Okay, we turn to the financial memorandum. We are running out of time, but some members have some questions around the financial memorandum. Can I come to Paul O'Kane?
Thank you, convener. I think just on the financial memorandum, I think the kind of analysis of that so far would suggest that there are essentially known unknowns, that we don't have clarity indeed on how many women may come forward in terms of using it. Therefore, the finances are still at this stage somewhat estimated. So I suppose I'm keen just to understand, firstly, what contingencies there would be within the FM to account for any increase, if you like, in the numbers of women coming forward that might have not been anticipated.
Fair questions. And I suppose what we've, knowing all along that we don't have confirmed official information about the numbers of women that have sought mesh removal surgery in the past, what we're trying to do to be helpful to the committee, hopefully, and to the Parliament, is to measure these things in a kind of per diem basis, so that if there's variation in terms of the number of nights stay or the number of people who have been accompanied against those that haven't, although our base assumption is that almost everybody going for this surgery will have had a partner, a husband or a partner or companion with them, just because of the practical circumstances. So what we've tried to do to help the process is to make it as simple as we can in terms of coping with variation as information becomes available. And I suppose it's best to be straightforward and honest in the circumstances, in that, you know, we policy officials have had a number of conversations with a number of people, you know, in different fora over the last little while, and we do get an overall. We have been kind of offered a kind of similar overall picture about the number of potential applicants. We can't know for sure, of course, that there aren't people out there who just are hidden from us at the moment because they don't, you know, they're not involved. That's definitely a risk. But what we try to do in all of these estimates, provide for variation, and where there's a plausible risk that somebody's not going to have receipts, a taxi or a lunch, which is perfectly understandable, that we come to some sort of kind of standard approach whereby somebody's fairly reimbursed for those reasonable expenses.
Thank you. Carol Mockin.
Thank you. Thanks very much for the information. So far, I'm very interested, just leading on from that question, about how we make sure, if there are any women out there who don't know about the scheme or don't know how to apply for the scheme, how we make sure that information is very accessible and that the women do feel at ease to apply should they have to. Has there been any work on that?
It is certainly as Terry and others have said, we wish it wasn't the case. Of course, we don't, but we recognise that there's a nervousness about interacting directly with the government on this because of the circumstances. So we have been throughout seeking to work with the Health and Social Care Alliance, which I think is for others to judge finally, but I think has got a lot of expertise in terms of engaging with groups that are sometimes hard to reach and who are ambivalent about working directly with the government. So they have held a number of focus groups over the last little while to inform the development of the scheme, of the bill, and on other points. So we'll continue to do that. We'll continue to work through National Services Scotland, which has the established routes. We know that many hundreds of people have already applied for the Scottish Government Mesh Fund. And whilst we can't be certain, we would imagine that anybody that's applied for the Mesh Fund, people that apply for the Mesh Fund, will include those that have that might be relevant in terms of the bill. So there will be that route as well. And of course, I hope it goes without saying that the Scottish Government will use all of its channels if the bill gains royal assent to publicise the scheme through social media and through other steps to bring it to people's attention.
And we have a short question. I think it might be our final question. I'm just looking across my members to double check from Emma Harper.
Thanks, Convener. It might be that, I mean, Greg's kind of alluded to this already. In the bill, in the financial memorandum, it says it's expected upon establishment of a scheme that all applications will be made within 1 year of the scheme opening. So with the social media advertising, or I suppose you'll know who already has had mesh implant surgery, is the 1 year time frame quite narrow, or is that, you think that's reasonable?
I think we hope it will be reasonable. I suppose what we will want to ensure is that we align the activity so that we open the scheme after we've made people aware of it, and we would hope that a year will be sufficient, and it instinctively feels that a full calendar year after the scheme opening will provide enough time. That period, I suppose one thing worth saying is that period will be a period for applications. As a number of members have said, and I'm sure will be the case, there will be, just because of the complexity of the circumstances, I'm sure there will be a number of cases where the determination of any grant or payment continues on after that year. So there's no date specified for that. But that will be based on the circumstances of each case. I don't know if Ilse would like to kind of qualify anything I've said there.
No, I'm very happy with everything that Greg said there. Thank you.
Thank you very much. That's as asked all of our questions of you. I want to thank you all for your time this morning and for clarifying certain aspects of the bill and the scheme as you develop it. At our next meeting on the 2nd of November, the committee will continue its scrutiny of the Transvaginal Mesh Removal Cost Reimbursement Scotland Bill and consider some subordinate legislation. But that concludes the public part of our meeting today. Thank you, everyone.